So in this video, I want to briefly talk about broadcasting, which is a concept that makes working with vector and matrix computations more convenient on a computer compared to, for example, pen and paper or the traditional way of doing linear algebra. All right, so let's start with vectors. So if you look at this notation here, W transpose X plus B equals Z. So do you recall how this is called? Like, to check yourself, there's a certain word for that result. Maybe pause the video, think about it briefly. Yeah, so the result is net input. So we learned in the perceptron lecture that we usually call that the net input. So I'm just providing this as a simple example here. So where X and W would be two vectors here. So we would do W transpose dot X plus B, and this would be the proper linear algebra way of computing the net input. So in linear algebra, the supported operations for a vector are addition. You can also think of subtraction if we add a vector with negative values. And then the inner products, like the dot product, would be one of them. And scalar multiplication, so we can multiply a vector by a scalar. So these are the only proper, I would say, basic vector operations that you would find in a traditional linear algebra textbook. Now, in practice, though, if you work on a computer, there are a few more possibilities that can make our life easier. They wouldn't be, I would say, valid linear algebra operations in the traditional sense. So let's say if you write a paper for a linear algebra journal or something, they would maybe complain about this if you would do this on pen and paper. But on a computer, it's possible, for example, to add a scalar value to a vector. So also you can, so let's start at the top. So let's say we have two vectors, A and B, here implemented as PyTorch tensors, a one-dimensional PyTorch tensors. So what we can do in PyTorch is we can multiply these two tensors. So that is something in traditional linear algebra which would be not valid, but here it is, which is nice. And then the other one is adding a scalar to a vector. So what will happen is it will add the value 1 to each individual element in the vector, which is also convenient. You have to be a little bit careful about that. Sometimes it's easy to make or to compute something that you don't intend, so it can also make mistakes a little bit easier. But in many, many cases, this makes life easier, so you don't have to, for example, in a traditional algebra sense, a linear algebra sense, what you would have to do is you would have to create a vector of ones and add it. For example, you would have then 1, 2, 3, plus 1, 1, 1, right? So that would be the linear algebra way. But here, you don't have to create this explicitly. It will implicitly add this one, which is kind of nice. So that would be one convenience function. This is also related to the concept of broadcasting, which I will explain further in the next couple of slides. Now in the next couple of slides, we will be talking about some concepts around matrices that are different from the linear algebra traditional sense and linear algebra on the computer. So if you think back of the perceptron algorithm, this is typically considered an online algorithm. Online means it processes one training data point at a time. So if you think back, you do you look at one training data point and then you update or not, and then you look at the next data point and then you update or not. However, if you have trained your perceptron model, you can actually do the prediction on the test examples all at once. You don't have to do one data point at a time. This is because we don't train it anymore there, so we can really just feed it a gigantic matrix of n training examples and then do all the computations at once. This will make it more efficient because now we can do a matrix multiplication inside the perceptron instead of processing each feature vector. So instead of providing the first feature vector, doing the computation, the net input, and then doing the second one and so forth, we can now give it this gigantic matrix, so we can avoid having a for loop for prediction. That is essentially what I have written here. And the reason why it's more efficient is that the computer can leverage lower level routines to compute certain things in parallel. So there are two opportunities for parallelism. One is multiplying the elements to compute the dot product. So if you have, let's say, a weight vector here. So let me, there's no space really, but let's say we have my a weight vector here. And then if we multiply this weight vector with the first feature vector, so there's a multiplication between the first element, multiplication between second element, and so forth until the last element. And these multiplications can be done all in parallel and then summed up. That would be one way for parallelizing that. The second way would be parallelizing the dot products. So while you compute the dot product here, I'm showing you in pink, you can have a second process running that already computes the dot product between the second row and this vector, and then one in parallel that already computes this and this, and then lastly this and this. So if you have four processors, for example, you could compute all these four dot products in parallel at the same time. You don't have to wait until one finishes, right? So in that way you can make the computation more efficient. So you have a little question for CS majors who are maybe familiar with the notation big O. So what would be the big O complexity of matrix multiplication if you assume that we have two n times n matrices? That's just like a optional question, just seeing if you know this. You can post this on Piazza, we can have a little discussion. But of course also non-CS majors are invited to participate in this discussion, but I'm just curious if you are familiar with these things. All right, like I mentioned, there are these two opportunities for parallelism. Here's a more concrete example, computing the net input. Now, instead of having a single feature vector, we have now this matrix, the design matrix, which is n times m matrix. N is the number of data points, m is the number of features, and w is a m dimensional vector, right? So the output of this would be n times 1, right? So the output of multiplying x and w would be n times one dimensional vector. And this is also why we actually have this extra dimension for the vectors, because you can't really, in linear algebra in the traditional sense, you can't really compute or multiply, do a matrix multiplication between a matrix and a vector. You can only do a dot product between two vectors and a matrix multiplication between two matrices. So in this way, for correctness, this vector W is actually a matrix, M times 1 matrix, so that we can do the matrix multiplication between the matrix and the feature vector. It's a little bit weird. It's just like, I'm just mentioning it here in terms of if you stumble upon it, if you have learned linear algebra in the traditional sense and you think maybe that doesn't make sense. In computer, in the computer computing context, we are a little bit more forgiving about these little things. All right, here's an example of computing the net input on the whole slide, and this is then z. Z would be a vector, so we would be adding the b to every dot product. So each of those is a dot product plus the bias unit, and that gives us the net input. So the net input is also a vector for the training example. So we have n data points, for example. I said training examples, but it would be more like the test data points in the context of the perceptron. In other algorithms that we will be talking about in the next few lectures, we can also do that with training examples. In the perceptron example, this would be technically the test examples, because, like I said in the previous slide, the perceptron is an online algorithm. It can only process one data point at a time. All right, moving on. So here's an example of that in PyTorch. So both NumPy and PyTorch are not very picky about traditional linear algebra notations. So I said before, this has to be n times m matrix, and w is a m times one vector. But PyTorch is not very picky about that, so we can actually also omit this dimension. So here I'm showing you a matrix, 2x3 matrix, And that's just a shortcut for making a matrix of values 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5. So it's a 2 by 3 matrix. And now I have a weight vector, just a one-dimensional vector, 1, 2, 3. And I can actually multiply x with w. Will give me a 8 times 26 vector with the values 8 and 26. So this would be also a vector with only one dimension and two elements. However, so instead of having this vector, I can add another dimension to this vector with this view function. This is similar to NumPy's reshape, which I explained in the tutorials that I provided to you. If this is unfamiliar, maybe refer to the NumPy tutorials again, where I explain the reshape and where the minus one comes from. But also, if this is confusing, please ask on Piazza. I'm really happy to explain that again. All right, so now the W here is now a vector. So this is a column vector, would be 1, 2, 3, with another dimension. So this is a matrix, m times 1 matrix now, like we had before here, and we can also do that. Note this is not necessary, but you can see now the output is also n times 1 dimensional, matching the number of rows here. This is n times 1 dimensional, whereas this one here is only n dimensional. So we have, there's n elements, so it's only one dimension. Yeah, it's a little bit confusing when we call or talk about dimensions. If we talk about a vector, we say n dimensional vector, it means it has the number of elements. If we say n dimensional array, it means the number of dimensions or axes. So here this is only one axis with n values, and this is an n times one matrix. So this is a vector in the traditional sense, and this is, you can think of it as a column vector. Or n times one matrix. But yeah, this is just nitpicking what I'm doing here. I'm just showing you that both ways are possible in PyTorch. Yeah, and if you like nitpicking or hair splitting, so there was actually one little mistake from a traditional linear algebra perspective in the previous slide. So here, just asking whether you can spot the mistake. So there's something here that is not possible in traditional linear algebra. So yeah, what's not possible here is that we are adding a scalar to a vector, right? So in a, well, let me go back. So here I'm actually adding it explicitly as a value, but in a traditional linear algebra sense, you can't add a scalar to a vector that is not valid. So in a traditional linear algebra sense, you would write it like this. But to be honest, in the context of deep learning, no one does that. It's way too much work. And yeah, we deep learning researchers are lazy. I just wanted to go over these things because, yeah, some of you might complain, what type of math am I using here? Because this is not making sense. I've learned that differently. So I just wanted to illustrate that in deep learning, we have our own rules in a way. All right. So, yeah, lastly, the topic I promised for this video is broadcasting. So, yeah, in broadcasting, what we do is we can add the one to the vector, like I just mentioned before. Not only that, it's also possible, yeah, to add a vector to a matrix, for example. So let's say we have a matrix here. So here I'm creating this matrix as a 2 by 3 matrix. The values 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. And now I have a tensor here, 1, 2, 3, the same as above. And I can now add this tensor to the matrix. And you can see it's adding these values 1, 2, and 3. To each of the rows. So it's adding 4, so the 1, 2, 3 to the upper row here, and it's adding also the 1, 2, 3 to the lower row here, so the results are shown as follows. So that is another thing that we can do in computing. So, and this is called broadcasting. So under the hood, PyTorch, and the same thing is also true for NumPy, they will create another dimension implicitly. So you can't see this dimension, but it will just do it internally because it's kind of guessing of what you want to do. So in this case, under the hood, basically, it's extending this one to a tensor. So then you can add these two tensors together, which will give you 2, 3, and 4. This is something that happens under the hood, and this is called broadcasting, like adding this implicit dimension. And the same thing happens here, where we have the matrix that we add to the vector, or the vector to the matrix. So there will be also this implicit dimension where the values are duplicated. And then, yeah, this also works. So yeah, this is the concept of broadcasting. And all I've shown you in this video was hopefully not too confusing. It's somewhat showing you that the rules in computing are a little bit more relaxed and more geared towards convenience compared to pen and paper linear algebra. All right, so then in the next video, I will go over some of the notational conventions for neural networks, and then briefly about cover some concepts related to fully connected layers in PyTorch and some more convention. So these videos in general, this today, a little bit drier than usual, but I think this is just some foundation that we will need when we talk about multi-layer networks soon.